Let's jump to the Lakers here. LeBron James, according to Brian Windhorst, he believes that LeBron is not going to pick up his player option this summer, with the idea being that he wants to re-sign with the Lakers and get a no-trade clause. So, Keith, what do you think about that concept, LeBron getting a no-trade clause? Why do you think he would want something like that, and does it make sense for him to not pick up his player option?
Yeah, no trade clauses are extremely rare in the NBA. True no trade clauses. We've been over the de facto no trade clause, is what we generally call it, where it's like a guy's on a 1-year deal or a 2-year deal, but second year is a player option and those kind of things. We know what those are. Those are actually somewhat common. But a true no trade clause, the only one right now in the league, is Bradley Beal. Because in order to get one, you have to have at least 8 years in the league, and you have to have four years with the same team. And you can't get it in an extension. So as we've seen guys sign more and more and more extensions, you can't add it unless it was in the previous deal. So Beal got his because Beal didn't extend. Beal went into free agency, signed a brand new contract with then Wizards, it went from there. I almost just called them the Bullets, and I have no idea where that came from. I don't know what I was thinking there. And then you have, like, Stephen Curry is an example. Everybody's like, how does Steph not have a no-trade clause? Because he's only ever extended. So in LeBron's case, he's in a position to sign a new deal. He meets the just barely meets the 8 years in the league requirement by, like, 2.5 times. then he's now got more than enough years with the Lakers, which sounds, I can't believe he's been with the Lakers for as long as he has. That part is all, that's just pandemic time screwing everything up, where, you know, 1 and 2 and 3 years all combined into like one like year. So why is LeBron asking for it? Because he can. I think this is a way to, hey, I don't want to get to a point in my last year when I'm making $50 million for the team to be like, you know, let's say he gets hurt, or it all does finally fall apart. He doesn't want to be in a spot where it's, hey, we're going to trade you to Charlotte because we have a chance to get LaMelo Ball and bring him in along with, I don't know, somebody else, Brandon Miller, and grow the team. And they just want you as the, you know, name for the rest of the season. So I think that's where he's just trying to protect himself. And I don't blame him for it. I also wouldn't blame the Lakers if they gave it to him, because I don't think there's a world where they're going to trade him anyway. I think if he gets traded, it's going to be, he asks and says, I want to be somewhere else, and the team accommodates that.
Agreed. Yeah. From everything I've heard, that's what it would take for the Lakers to actually trade LeBron James. LeBron would have to go to the Lakers and say, trade me. I do think he's going to sign a new deal with the Lakers this summer. I don't think he's going to leave. Who knows what's going to happen with Bronny, what's going to happen with him in terms of, does he go to the NBA? Does he go to college? I'm leaning he goes back to school. Which school, we don't know, but I'm leaning he goes back to school. So I don't think that's going to be a factor in LeBron's decision-making in terms of him potentially leaving to go play with Bronny. I think he winds up signing a new deal with the Lakers. Now, Windhorst also noted that there's some debate here, or maybe there'll be some negotiation in terms of, is it going to be, say, a 3-year contract? Is there going to be a player option at the end of it, a team option at the end of it, some non-guaranteed money? So that's going to be something else to keep an eye on this summer, is LeBron, the Lakers negotiating. He has until June 29th to make a decision whether or not to pick up his player option. But we'll have to imagine they'll start those negotiations pretty early and figure out, how many years do we want this contract to be? What do we want it to look like? And then what does that final year look like? Because we could be talking about LeBron in an age 41, 42. LeBron, crazy. I mean, that's what we're talking about. And I'm sure the Lakers will probably say, hey, dude, you're going to be 42. We want some non-guaranteed money, or we want the last year to be a team option. LeBron will probably say, hey, I'm LeBron James. I want a player option for that last year. And it'll be interesting to see how that dynamic plays out.
Yeah, I think we have all but removed the whole thought process of random team X drafts Bronny James to get LeBron to sign for whatever they can give him. I think that's out the window. I think as much as I do think he'd like to play with his son in the NBA, I think he has put it into a position where if it happens, great, but I'm not going to manufacture this to happen. Now, yeah, Bronny's in there and the Lakers have a second round pick, I wouldn't be surprised if there's a little push like, hey, what do you think about picking my kid? And if they're like, fine, it's the last roster spot, whatever, it's, you know, we're good. Maybe they go that direction. But I don't think it's going to be, you know, Charlotte drafts Bronny and he's like, well, I'm out of here. I'm a Hornet now. Like where people were, that was the storyline for months of he's going wherever Bronny goes. And I just think that's kind of over and done with. I also think it's unlikely. I don't even think Bronny's going to be in this draft. I think he may just say, you know what, I want to do a normal year of college somewhere else away from all of this and do all that. But all that said, with LeBron, a couple of things that stand out. One, you saying, like, we're talking about age 41, 42. Like, it's just bonkers. It doesn't even make sense anymore. The other thing, I was just looking at it. If he re-signs with the Lakers, that'll be his seventh season in L.A. next year, which is as many years as he was with the Cavs in his first run in Cleveland.
Pretty crazy,
like, that's crazy, right? Like, that's like, it's crazy that he's been now. He's not gonna, well, I shouldn't say he's not. I'm gonna say he's highly unlikely to match his full Cavs run, which was 7 years and 4 years for a total of 11. But he's probably gonna get to 7, 8, 9, maybe 10 years with the Lakers. We'll see. It you know, kind of depends on where it's all going, but yeah, just absolutely incredible. And I'm with you. They're going to want protections. He's going to say no. And that's where the dance will begin and all this stuff. And my only real hope is that everybody else says he's going back to LA. Can we just do free agency and trades and everything like normal people and not wait till LeBron decides on like July 15th, what he's doing. And then we start to move. Cause that we've just seen in the past, he holds everything up. Right, because everybody has to wait. I would hope everybody's like, this is not the same thing. I also think it may come quicker because I think once he gets off to, it's time to start prepping for the Olympics, he's going to want the contract done and finished and all that. Last piece, super important to know, new CBA rules, the minute the Lakers season ends, they can start talking new contract with LeBron. That is a new thing in the CBA. Teams can talk to their own free agents the minute the season ends. So guaranteed by the time the bell rings on June 30th at 6 p.m. Eastern, we're going to know what LeBron James and the Lakers, where they're standing and whether it's, hey, this was really a non-issue. They came to agreement, then off we go. Or there's some tension here and it's a little messy. We're going to have a really good idea when free agency opens.
So two things on that. I think number one, I think that the idea that LeBron is going to hold up free agency, I don't think it's going to happen. And part of that is, I agree with you, I don't think the teams are going to say, hey, we really have a shot at LeBron. I think it's going to be known, hey, he's just going to wind up going back to LA. So I think that's going to, it's not going to be like Kawhi years ago. Like, I remember packing for Summer League and then we're like well into free agency and everybody's still waiting on figuring out what Kawhi's going to do, right? I don't think that's going
to
happen.
It took an earthquake for him to decide.
It took an earthquake for that, for Kawhi to figure it out. I don't think that we're going to go down that path. I think teams are going to make their moves in free agency. It's what we've seen more in the last couple of years where free agency hasn't really been held up by any one particular player because teams have a better sense of whether or not they really have a shot at the guy and they're just going and making their moves and off they go. So I don't think LeBron's going to hold up free agency. However, I also don't think ahead of the draft, it's going to come out that, hey, LeBron's staying with the Lakers. I think what's going to happen is LeBron's going to hold their feet to the fire to some degree. He's going to say, hey, you got those three first-round picks that are tradable. What are we doing with them? You know, he's going to, metaphorically, right? LeBron's going to have the pen in his hand and he's going to be holding it over the contract and go, so what are we thinking here? How are those draft picks looking? What's happening here? What are you guys doing on the trade front? And then once the Lakers say, oh, we're trading for this guy, he's going to go, okay, cool, and sign. I think that's, he's going to use that leverage for a bit, but I don't think it's going to be a, you know, August 15th, we're still waiting to find out what LeBron does type of thing.
If it is, we're, I mean, we'll get a whole summer's worth of content, but boy, that's going to be a slow free agency process. Yeah, and I'm with you on the draft pick thing. It's funny. I was watching, I was listening to something the other day where they said, you know, what does he owe the Lakers from the standpoint of not making them mortgage their future? And I kind of laughed. And the one host said, he doesn't owe him anything. Like he wants to win a championship again, like, or multiple championships by the time his career ends. That is his only goal. And in the reality of it is, that's pretty much the Lakers' goal too. Yeah, if you can make a trade and it's a good trade with only sending two of the future picks, you do it. But if it takes all three to make a really good trade that's going to push you deeper into contention than you may be right now, then you have to swallow hard and do it, and we'll figure it all out later without draft picks and, you know, whatever the case may be with all that. And they're let's be real, they're fairly protected by the fact that they have all their other picks in the in between years. So that they're not, it's not like they're completely out of picks. They don't think they're going to do any kind of trade where, hey, it's every pick we can give you, so all three of them plus pick swaps and all this other stuff. I think teams are going to be extremely cautious of doing things like that. And I don't think that's where this will go. So only time will tell. And we'll see if that is how it happens.
All right. While on the topic of the Lakers, this is, very quick, easy, no surprise here. D'Angelo Russell, Brian Windhorst believes he's going to decline his player option. Windhorst and everyone else in the world assumes that D'Angelo Russell is going to decline his player option. He's had a fantastic season for the Lakers. He's really been phenomenal. Keith, you and I have talked about it on here, so I won't spend a ton of time on it, but essentially, even if, and I don't think this is going to happen, but even if he just signs a new deal at his current number, which would be about $18 million and change, he would at least not pick up his player option so he can extend the number of years he has on his contract. I do think he's going to get a bump. He's going to get a raise. But again, he's had a phenomenal season. This is the reason why there's a player option in the contract from his perspective. It's so he can opt out and cash in after he has a big year, and that's exactly what he's done.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, the Lakers got him at a really nice number for this year, and D'Lo's protection in that whole process was, if we go back to roughly, what was it, 9 months or so ago when this was all going down in the beginning part of July, it was, they're only signing him to a number that's tradable and he's going to get traded. And whether it was for Kyrie Irving or any number of other players that have come up, in his protection was, well, I want the player option one, then I can control things to a point, because he did give up his no trade clause in that. And that was also another thing that he, because now we talked about no trade clause earlier before with LeBron, players can negotiate that away now. Even if you do get the de facto one, you can say, no, I won't block a trade. And D'Lo is probably the highest profile guy to do it so far. Didn't end up mattering. They didn't trade him, obviously, but he gave that option up. And that was, again, part of getting the player option was, hey, we're going to give you full control over this, but no, anytime in this year, while you're playing at $17.5 million or so, we may trade you and then figure it out in your new team. And instead it turned into, he's been, I would say, their third most important player on the team this season. And he's played really well. So now it's come down to, all right, what happens here? And I'm with you on, even if he opts out and then resigns, it's probably going to be, maybe he gets just kind of the standard bump to like $20 million or something, sure, but it's going to be right within range of where he's at. But he'll add on a couple more years. And I think what you're going to see him and maybe a couple other guys do, it's going to be, how long is LeBron signing for? Okay, match me to that. In that way, because D'Lo is only 28. Like, he's not 34 years old and on his last contract. Like, he should have a couple more, one more contract at least after this one in him. So I think he may look at it and say, what's LeBron doing? Match me to that as far as years and options and other things go. And I think the idea behind that is, hey, if it's going great, I'll stick around then. But if LeBron moves on, we go. And I think if you're Lakers, you're kind of looking at it and saying, we're okay with that too. Because whenever LeBron goes, there's some form of reset coming anyway. It has to happen. So this is a chance for us. If we really don't want that contract or that player, we could kind of reset easier without being locked into fully guaranteed money.
My prediction on D'Lo, and we'll see if it comes true, it's 3 years, $65 million with a player option on the final year. That's my prediction.
Yeah, it sounds
what it ultimately looks like. That's
in range. I mean, it maybe could be a little higher. Could be like $70 million, sure, but that's quibbling over. You know, what's a few million between good friends?
Exactly.